Silverstone racetrack. I'm on a journey to expose what our politicians rarely tell you about the British economy.
We're being a little bit cautious here.
Be cautious, David. I'm very happy with you being cautious.
Our British business leaders are selling off our best companies for quick and easy profits.
We appear to have lost the great innovations and they've been taken abroad, made somewhere else.
I want to show what I believe is a great British sell-off that's creating a dumbed-down, low-wage Britain.
ICI at the time was one of Europe's biggest chemical companies, and now nothing, literally zero, it's gone.
In the last 10 years, £440 billion of British companies have been sold abroad, the biggest cull in our history.
People that have owned the stock for a week determine the future of a business forever.
But that's not all. We're losing control of almost any industry where we're still world beaters.
I just think if anything's any good, you should hang on to it.
But if we confront what I see as a major crisis, we could become one of the wealthiest nations on Earth.
I want everybody to be reminded that Britain can be great. We were once and we can be again.
Dawn. In a hotel car park on the English-Welsh border, there are echoes of a Britain from the not-so-distant past. A Britain that had ambition. A Britain that, whatever its weaknesses, still had the will to compete. This is the annual Land's End to John O'Groats Classic Car Rally, where the icons of our once proud car industry are being put through their paces against their overseas counterparts.
Jeremy Clarkson, eat your heart out.
50 years ago, Britain owned some of the world's best and biggest companies and brands. Not anymore. Today in Britain, it almost feels like we don't do ownership.
3, 2, 1, go.
The men and women competing here are passionate about the past glories these cars represent, in part because there are so few to celebrate in the present. British-owned car makers are virtually extinct. MG, Land Rover and the Mini are now owned by one-time competitors from China, India and Germany. We do assemble cars, around 1.5 million of them, but today we are subcontractors to the world. Decisions are made at headquarters in other countries by executives from those countries in their own strategic interests.
I think the, you know, the classics, it's all about the British cars.
It's the Britishness, you say?
Yeah, yeah. I've got a Triumph saloon, actually. For me, it is already historic. It's part of the past.
It is astounding how many people come up to us and say, I knew somebody who had a Rover. It's a good car, and I mean, it's 52 years old, it's reliable, it's well-built. Why can't we still do that sort of thing now?
When you look at these cars, I mean, they were remarkable, and the designers, the engineers who built them, plainly loved what they were doing and loved making these artifacts that 50, 60 years on, we celebrate in this way. And what it makes me feel is, why the hell did we not care about ownership?
Foreign companies do care about ownership. In my opinion, they have a clear purpose, invest in their future, and plan for long-term profits. British businesses face unique pressures to make quick profits, then cut and run. Too often, they're little more than pawns in a country that loves financial wheeler-dealing. That's why so many industries, from IT to chemicals, have been made to fail and sold out abroad. This car rally is just the beginning of my journey to expose the plunder of Britain. In Manchester, this tower is a reminder of a British industrial giant, Imperial Chemical Industries, ICI. It was once Britain's largest manufacturer. This was where they did the research and development, the R&D, that created revolutionary products. Its closest competitor was a German firm called BASF. They're now the biggest chemical firm in the world. ICI, meanwhile, ceased to exist in 2008. It was sold to a Dutch competitor and dismembered.
The first thing that hits you at the top of this tower which was part of the old ICI Research Division, is just how huge this site was. Below us, a really extensive space, almost as far as the eye can see, occupied by property, albeit nice property, or derelict. But what used to be one of the biggest R&D intensive research sites in Europe. ICI at the time was one of Europe's biggest chemical companies, and now nothing. I mean, literally zero, it's gone. Exit R&D, enter property. It couldn't be a more eloquent statement of what's going to happen in Britain.
The sheer magnitude of what is happening is extraordinary. Over the last 10 years, Britain has sold off our companies to foreigners at more than twice the rate we have bought abroad. This is the real deficit that matters. I'm back in my adopted hometown, Oxford, where for the past 4 years, I've been the principal of Hertford College, part of Oxford University. I'm a political economist, and for 25 years, I've been observing with growing alarm what's happening to the British economy.
Hi. Acres of British industry and commerce that has simply been cashed out, sold out, squandered, vandalized. And the people who do that think that somehow they're kind of doing something good, that they're setting up things for their future. My point is, you sell these assets off with no regard for the future, you end up not having a future.
Oxford is home to a modern industry that is a British world leader, arming us with skills for the future.
Elbows.
But foreign buyers are already moving in.
Aren't you going to give me a battle axe or a kind of, you know, bazooka or a, you know, lance?
We'll give you those later.
Okay.
Gaming company Rebellion is setting me loose in a state-of-the-art motion capture studio.
I can sprint. God, look at that!
Isn't it?
I'm walking in. Oh, my God, this is unbelievable.
Now that skeleton.
This is the most extraordinary thing. You're giving me a beard. What a beard. And actually, what you've done with this is you've disguised, I mean, the fact that I've got this enormous paunch, which I'm sure this camera is showing, this camera is actually rather disguising.
Rebellion's turnover is 15 million a year, and they've had a number one hit for virtually every one of their 21 years in business.
Look at that.
Their owner is Jason Kingsley.
Can I sit down on this chair?
Yep. We don't actually have a virtual chair. So what you're doing now is lining up the virtual chair with the real chair that's going to be captured, so you'll be able to lift up the virtual chair now.
Oh, so they're creating a virtual chair?
They've put a chair in virtually.
So I'm... I see.
Jason's part of a vast global business. Gaming is bigger than Hollywood and bigger than the entire music industry. But while Rebellion remains British-owned, it's in the minority.
I'd be suspended.
Over the last decade, the bulk of its contemporaries in the gaming industry have sold out or gone bust.
Marking it.
As many British game developers grow, so they're beating a familiar path into foreign ownership. It's one that Jason is determined to avoid.
In the UK, we can be number one in the world in making computer games without any question at all.
Why do you think it is that, you know, there aren't more British-owned companies in this booming industry in which we seem to be bloody good?
We get bought a lot. I mean, British companies get bought very early on. We're brilliant at starting things up. We're pretty good at taking them through the sort of middle range, and then we tend to sell quickly.
Entrepreneurs everywhere need cash to grow their companies. But British banks, historically reluctant to lend to fledgling firms, have grown even more wary. So companies are forced to resort to investors who, in exchange for cash, want control. And with it, the chance to make a quick profit by selling the company on.
Two of my friends sold two of their companies, one in Cambridge and one here in Oxford. One was bought by Google for a lot of money and one was bought by Zynga for a lot of money, both American companies. So that innovation is now US owned. And those people that gave money to start up went, we'll have that, thank you very much. We'll leave and go and have a nice meal.
More than a nice meal for that kind of money.
Well, yeah.
but I mean, does it matter? I mean, a lot of people say it's a sign of our success that they do this.
What it means is we don't have those massive success stories in the same way. And a lot of creation happens here, and then the value of it is captured by US companies, by the US stock market, I guess, by the French stock market, Japanese stock market.
And how do you feel about that?
It's a real shame. It would be nice to think that in 25 years we'll look back and there'll be some companies that stuck to their guns, kept ownership in these shores and became world-leading corporations in their own right.
But the loss of British startups isn't inevitable. At Oxford University's Side Business School, Professor Colin Mayer has researched what happens in other countries. In Germany, famous firms like BMW and Bosch are still controlled by their founders. They get cash for investment from German banks.
Why do so many companies, as they grow, sell out?
In Britain, if you want to raise finance, then you have to sell shares. And in the process of selling those shares, you lose control. Let me contrast, for example, in Germany. Banks finance them. The banks provide long-term finance. So one of the factors that's contributing to this loss of ownership in Britain is that they cannot get the same sort of funding that is available elsewhere in the world.
So to grow means you have to sell out.
Exactly.
It's not just startups. Big British firms are also at risk. 25 years ago, nearly half of British shares were owned by long-term investors, like pension funds. Today, it's just 15%. Short-term speculators here now have more influence than almost anywhere else in the world. To my eyes, our companies have become chips in the stock market casino. Other countries have taken steps to avoid this.
Trading is the same all around the world. In New York, in Germany, the speed at which shares are traded is very similar to what's observed in London. The big difference is, in London, when you trade those shares, you can take over control of companies. In most countries around the world, when you trade those shares, they are not shares that you are controlling the companies behind them.
Why is that happening?
Because we don't allow companies to have something known as dual class shares. They're not allowed to retain the voting control of the company.
When the founders of Google floated their company on the New York Stock Exchange, they used regulations not available in Britain to keep control of their company. Although they only had 3.7% of the shares, they kept 37% of the votes. Why? It would help to prevent Google from being taken over, they said, and allow the management to think long term. Small wonder Britain doesn't have any Googles.
Whether agreed or hostile, the scale of takeovers in Britain runs at up to 10 times of that in Germany or Japan, twice that of the United States. But in the city, many don't see that as a problem. Unlike me, they believe it's only weak or mismanaged British companies that have anything to fear from global market forces. Until last summer, Giles Wilkes was special advisor to Business Secretary Vince Cable.
I don't think a hostile takeover is per se good or bad. What is the major protection against managers building white elephants or constructing their own private empires if they do not have either aggressive shareholders or people who are saying, look, you're not running this company well, we might take it over instead? It's a pretty good check on imperial ambitions.
The marketplace is a check on so-called imperial ambitions. You just do that. You just end up chasing whatever short-term profitable bus is passing.
I mean, some of the other ownership models, they do work if you have a genius in charge. But when you have a family who just hangs on to it forever, I'm not actually sure that they will necessarily be making the best decisions for the company or for the economy in the long run.
There's one firm whose story, I believe, shows how easy it is to buy British companies and why British ownership matters. A few years ago, it was a world beater, with the popularity and self-assurance reflected in this viral marketing sensation, where the name of the brand is never even mentioned. Cadbury seemed an unlikely takeover target, but trouble was on its way. On my journey across Britain, I've discovered the scale of the sell-off of British companies abroad and how countries like Germany and America stop this happening to them.
Our government delights in boasting that Britain is open for business, but this is what that really means.
The country is the easiest in the world for a company to be taken over.
And there's one takeover that brought this alive like no other. Nearly 200 years old, Cadbury grew from a one-shop operation to become one of the biggest confectionery brands in the world and one of the country's best-loved firms. Next to their enormous factory still churning out chocolate bars here in the Midlands, they even built a tourist attraction, Cadbury World.
I'll go for the back of these. What are you going to have?
I'm going to have this one here, whatever that is.
It's molten dairy milk, you realise.
I've come here with historian Deborah Cadbury, a distant cousin of the chocolate makers. She's chronicled how this hugely successful company became a takeover victim.
We all love chocolate, but also more than that, the company stood as a, you know, an icon, a beacon of good practice over many generations.
Right up to the takeover, Cadbury had a reputation for looking after its workers. It began in the 1880s when they built not just a factory, but an entire village in the Midlands countryside. They called it Bourneville.
The idea was that if you took people from the inner cities and put them in an environment that gave them some dignity, they would thrive. And they really tried to put that into practice.
In my view, this counts. In my view, it matters. And in my view, it did matter that the firm that embodied all of this, you know, carried on as a British-owned institution with this hardwired into its DNA.
For over 100 years, that strong sense of stewardship was passed down through three generations, from George to his son Edward to grandson Adrian Cadbury.
Adrian, how nice. This is Will.
So, Sir Adrian, this is Chateau Cadbury.
Adrian spent nearly four decades working at the family firm, two of them as its chair.
The corner of it is 1879. That back bit is where I had my office.
You can have lived in sniffing distance of the factory and you worked in its shadow. Yeah,
absolutely.
This is yours, isn't it?
This
is fantastic.
In 1969, well before the days of computerized share trading, the Cadburys took their company to the stock exchange and publicly sold shares to raise money for expansion.
Do you regret that the family turned the company into a public company and by so doing ultimately lost control and ultimately the fate of the enterprise?
And that is absolutely true, and it's a very good point, but I think you don't see it quite like that. I mean, I saw growing and moving ahead and broadening the base of the business as worthy objectives.
It was a very different world then because shareholders were much more in it for the long term. Shareholder profile has changed so much because at first you were able to carry on really building the business for the long term and had the complete support of the shareholders in doing this.
The Cadbury ethos remained intact even after the family left the running of the company to others. But in 2010, it faced the greatest challenge in its history. A hostile takeover by US food giant Kraft.
The mood pretty grim in Bourneville today. Kraft tabled a £10 billion bid for the company this afternoon.
We hadn't asked for it. We didn't welcome it. Kraft basically delivered a pretty clear position that this was the beginning of a takeover, and if it was one that we didn't actually agree to by choice, it would become hostile.
Cadbury's chairman at the time, Sir Roger Carr, is one of Britain's most experienced businessmen. He's headed six major public companies and is no stranger to takeovers. But this was one deal he didn't want.
Not much of a welcoming committee for US giant Kraft. Cadbury's chairman responded almost immediately, calling the offer derisory.
But Kraft's bid had already alerted anyone in search for quick and easy profit. Speculators piled in, betting Kraft would make a higher offer. Cadbury was now in play on London's stock market casino, and its British board had no way to veto a sale. In a few weeks, hedge funds went from owning 5% to 30% of the company's shares.
Their ambition is very clear. It is to make the maximum amount of money in the shortest possible time.
I mean, how did you feel about that, given how you knew who your new shareholders were?
I think emotionally, it is always somewhat disturbing that people that have owned the stock for a week can determine the future of a business forever. I mean, we were reminded as a board, if we failed to take these offers, then they would be looking to sue the board for failure to do their duty for shareholders.
Cadbury's values and vision legally counted for nothing. Its ownership was now widely dispersed amongst new shareholders with a clear and immediate priority, the money on the table now. So Cadbury was sold. The jury's out on whether the Kraft deal has been good or bad for Cadbury workers. But what is clear is that the destiny of a big British employer, a world brand, a long-standing innovator, is out of our hands. And it's not just chocolate.
We have the most liberal market for foreign takeovers of any country in the world. One of the primary reasons why is that the government does not intervene in the event of acquisitions on the grounds of national concerns. That's very different from many other countries. There is nowhere else in the world, not even in the United States, where there is a system of such dispersed ownership and companies cannot defend themselves against acquisitions.
I don't want to stop foreigners buying British companies, but the pendulum swung too far.
Time and again, we sell off assets and brands built up over decades for uncertain benefit. The true beneficiary is the city, a stage army of directors, investment bankers, lawyers, accountants, and intermediaries who certainly get very rich.
Of course, it's true the fees the city makes do contribute to the British economy.
Probably we've become a global centre for the expertise in this. Whether that's a good thing or not, it's clearly good as an industry in that you'll have a lot of people coming here and making their living in the city in that business. You'd have to build a very strong case to say we would rather it took place elsewhere, because the presence of all these consultants and lawyers and bankers and accountants in the UK is damaging all these other industrial interests who are being traded too frenetically as a result of them being here and not elsewhere.
And you're doing my case is strong enough?
Well, I think nobody makes a stronger one. It's just you need an awful lot to shift the way things currently are, because the gains are uncertain and the costs are very vocal.
For me, it's about proportionality and priorities. The city is a national asset, but financial deal-making shouldn't be the only activity we cherish. It comes at a price. These continual sell-offs also impact on who we are as a nation and get into the very marrow of our being. I'm on my way to one of the most famous streets in the country.
So what does it feel like to be back in Coronation Street?
It feels like a real privilege, to be honest. And certainly to see
I've come to Coronation Street to meet Paul Abbott. He started out as one of the show's youngest ever scriptwriters.
As it used to be. When I walked on the street, I nearly fainted for the first time because you're touching doors that belong to the TV for all that time.
Today, Paul is one of our most prolific and respected writers and producers, creator of hits like State of Play, Clocking Off and Shameless.
It's like the NHS, isn't it, really, Corrie?
It's become part of British culture.
Yeah.
But Coronation Street is made by ITV, a broadcaster that's being stalked by foreign buyers. Many city analysts believe it will follow Channel 5 into American ownership within 5 years. Hundreds of the companies which make programmes for our broadcasters have also been sold overseas. Paul is one of a dwindling number of producers who insist they won't sell.
How would you characterise the kind of health of the TV industry now?
I think the creative output looks great, but the creative output that looks great has all been made by people who've now been bought up by global companies who, you know, they swallow beautiful small companies to turn them into output machines, and their distinctiveness gets lost.
Lots of people, I mean, you know, Abbott Vision, independent production company, I mean, there are people who beat their path to your door wanting to buy you.
Yeah.
Why do you say no?
I just think if anything's any good, you should hang on to it. I think owning your own mind is really important. And you can just imagine somebody making a, you know, good offer to buy me up, and then they'd be telling me what they wanted to write, and they'd be describing what kind of series they want to come out, and automatically I think I'd just shut down.
Tickets this way for the Chatsworth Express!
One of Paul's many hits, Shameless, reflected a Britishness that had never been seen on our screens when it first appeared in 2004.
The kids are convinced
I'm actually theirs.
Stay away!
But today, TV is fast becoming a battleground for global tech and communications mega-corporations. They want content that would work anywhere in the world, not creativity like this aimed at British audiences.
It's the power of, as you've described it, the suits in the room, saying, you know, we need American sensibility. I mean, just suppose Coronation Street wasn't owned by a British company embedded here in Manchester. Could it be Coronation Street?
No. No, I think everything about British television is represented in Coronation Street. Its cherished aspects wouldn't be sustained, I don't think, by a different kind of owner.
The companies buying up our culture have the same priorities as those buying up the rest of our industries. We've given them our services, our resources, even the social glue that holds us together. Small wonder that Britain faces a crisis of identity and growing uncertainty about how we can be better.
Our carelessness about ownership, I believe, imbues the way we sold off our public assets when we privatised them. It seems to me not enough was done to ensure the new private owners put into the long-term purpose of these former public assets.
Privatisation was an opportunity to transform these essential public services with new ideas and fresh investment and offer a better deal for all of us. Sometimes it's worked, far too often it hasn't. The reason is that the true purpose of these companies is ambiguous. Is it to deliver a great service to the public or to hand over as much money as possible to their owners?
Nowhere is that clearer than in the industry delivering our most vital resource. 60% of the British water industry today is owned by private equity funds, many of them based abroad. The largest water company, Thames, was taken over in 2006 by an international consortium headed by an Australian investment bank. At the Open University, they've analysed the accounts for Thames Water. First, they had to untangle its complex financial structure, involving no less than 7 holding companies.
When we dug into that Byzantine structure and looked at the accounts, we saw in the 5 years, for example, to 2012, Thames Water has become, in a sense, a nice little earner for investors. The simple household water bill finds its way through all of these companies, and I think because a lot of the money has been shooting through the company structure off to investors globally, there's very little left.
Over this period, Dr. Pryke found investors had received over £1 billion in dividend payments and discovered something even more surprising.
When we looked at the accounts, it was quite striking that Thames Water paid out more in dividends than it actually earned in profits. One, it's surprising that you can pay out more in dividends than you're actually earning. And secondly, quite dramatic increase in the amount of debt held on Thames Water's balance sheet.
Adding in more recent accounts, Thames has still paid out in dividends £1.4 billion of the £1.7 billion it's made in profits after tax since 2006. The company is now laden with around £8 billion of debt.
Thames is now building the Tideway Tunnel, a vast new super sewer to serve London. The problem is that the company is so indebted, it nearly didn't get the money to go ahead with the £4 billion project. The loans only came through when the government, and so the taxpayer, underwrote the whole project.
Further along the Thames, there's an old Victorian pumping station. Once vital to supplying the capital's water, it's now the London Museum of Water and Steam. I'm here to meet with one of the key figures involved in the privatisation of the water industry and its first regulator, Sir Ian Byatt.
The big thing was to show the public that a privately owned company could deliver better water, better quality water, at reasonable prices.
The museum is a reminder of an era Sir Ian hoped the new industry would emulate. 100 years ago, great engines like these pumped water for miles under the city, helping to realise the ambition of clean water and sanitation for all Londoners.
It's fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah.
British water industry doing its thing.
We were promised a utopia, a private sector efficiency to rival these achievements. But the man who had hoped to deliver it is today disillusioned by how it's turned out.
I think if companies make big profits, then some of that money should be retained for future investment and not simply paid out in dividends. So I'm doubtful about Thames's real commitment to customers. And the scale of dividends that they pay to themselves confirms me in that view. And so I'd like to see changes in the arrangements whereby if companies do make larger profits than expected, they automatically reduce prices at the same time as they may be paying out bigger dividends.
How does a customer feel the consequence of how Thames Water is run?
I think that the customer should worry about the fact that the dividends paid out have been very high and the customers would have to pay for that.
In the end, the customer always pays.
Unfortunately, that is often the case.
Thames Water didn't provide anyone to put its case, but says its debts are sustainable and that its commitment to its customers is shown by spending over £1 billion a year on infrastructure while keeping bills amongst the lowest in the country. But there's another way for a private company to supply water.
Just going to have a quick look a minute to see if it's full.
I'm in South Wales on a call-out with drain unblocker Geraint Williams.
Do you want to give it a go? I'll get it in, eh?
Am I going to get covered in shit?
No, you won't get covered in shit. What are you doing? You're feeling for the channel? Have a little feel around, see what you can feel. Can you feel thickness down there?
Yeah, I can feel it.
You in it?
Yeah, there's many things I thought was going to happen in my life, but this was not one of them.
Geraint's employer, Welsh Water, was privatised just like the rest of the industry.
Can we have a little feel?
Yeah.
Is it thick in it?
But Welsh Water is now set up in a completely different way. Its stated purpose, unambiguously, is to provide customers with the highest quality water and wastewater services at affordable prices. It's owned and managed to produce that result.
You've unblocked it. Fantastic. Look at that.
And when it's finished emptying, we'll get the camera down. Hopefully we'll be able to see a little bit more. Sometimes there is no reason, but sometimes it is.
And the typical reason is?
Wet wipes. Can you see it in the distance? Look, see the white?
Yeah.
Now that's wet wipes, that is. That's basically what caused this blockage.
Welsh Water pays no dividends to investors. The only dividends this company pays are to its customers.
When we took over Welsh Water, the water element of the bill was the highest of any of the big companies. Today it's below average. And we have returned money to our customers as well.
Chief Executive Chris Jones wrote the new approach into the company's constitution, legally binding them to honour it.
How hard was it to get it all together?
I think it was genuinely a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Genuine, clean sheet of paper, design a company, an ownership structure and so on from scratch. We thought, well, you know, you look at it, it's a big infrastructure business. What this really needs is secure, low-cost finance for the long term.
Cardiff's water treatment plant is a major part of the company's £3 billion investment programme.
Well, this is the key sort of treatment stage, actually, within these big tanks. All the air being bubbled in and so on.
They haven't needed the government to underwrite the loans that built this. It's a stark contrast to Thames Water's super sewer.
Still quite smelly, isn't it?
Well, it is a little bit.
Oh, my God.
So that's the end product of the business. What's left in here is still very valuable in terms of a natural organic fertiliser. We invest in all this long-term infrastructure with no support from the government at all. It's something that many other companies look on with envy. So, you know, we live with the assets that were built 20, 30, even 100 years ago. So we know the decisions we take today have got to be right, not just for customers today, but, you know, in 30 years' time, in 60 years' time.
Privatisation can make sense, and Welsh Water shows that. But it also shows that it matters how the privatised company is owned. It was not that privatisation is a bad idea. What was a bad idea was selling off public assets into PLCs with much less thought given to how those PLCs would curate and steward the public assets now under their control, with the results that we now see. And frankly, you get customers ripped off, and the country ripped off too.
The great British sell-off has seen off swathes of our companies, our services, even our sense of self. But the next stage of my journey is to investigate how we can once again start building world-beating companies that bring prosperity, skilled jobs, and pride back to Britain. In Britain, we desperately need to start building a new generation of great companies that are world beaters. Companies that can unlock all the potential this country has to offer.
Whoa, look at this, wow.
I began my journey on a classic car rally. To discover the way forward, I'm back in the bucket seat.
Ah, fantastic. Oh my God. You're quite good at this, aren't you?
That knows a circuit. What?
At the wheel is former World Rally Champion David Richards. His company now runs Aston Martin's official racing team.
The car we go to Le Mans with is based upon this very car. These are road tyres, and I don't want to ruin the set of road tyres, so we're being a little bit cautious here.
Don't worry, you be cautious. Be cautious, David. I'm very happy with you being cautious.
This is just one part of what David's company does. Whilst Aston Martin is owned by foreign investors, David is a British owner of a British company. His business, ProDrive, is one of the few British firms successfully to scale up. It turns over in excess of £50 million a year and has developed race and rally cars for everyone from Porsche to Ford. To succeed, David had to have control and be ruthless over what his company does and how it can continue to grow.
I wanted us to be a business based on knowledge, applying our skills and talents to engineering challenges, rather than building some enormous factory that had lots of machinery to make things and do things. Because to be a manufacturing-based economy, we don't necessarily have to make things per se. It's about the creation of those ideas and the retention of those ideas. So often in the past, we appear to have lost the great innovations and they've been taken abroad, made somewhere else, and we've not retained the value in the intellectual property.
But the future actually is a knowledge-based economy. Is not so much, you know, what you can touch. It's actually the know-how in the composite, the know-how kind of in the engines. I mean, am I wrong?
No, you're exactly right.
This is why British ownership should matter to us. In the 21st century, owning and trading on ideas is what will drive success, less the physical products they create. That's why global giants buy up British startups for big bucks. And it's why ProDrive has been able to open up new frontiers, even making parts for the next European space mission to Mars. It's all driven by the clear vision of its owner.
Suddenly we find people coming to us for solutions to problems that we were very well capable of delivering. And today we might as well be putting machinery on Mars as much as we'll be building parts for a racing car.
There's only one future for Britain. It's doing more things like this. There's so many areas, life sciences, robotics, aerospace, where Britain, if it chose, if it really went for it, could be a world beater.
What's stopping us? It's not lack of ideas or creativity. I believe it's the myopic focus on the short term, which kills our capacity to innovate. Until we enable companies to realize a vision over time, we'll never get enough small companies scaling up to become large ones. And without them, it's hard to take advantage of the breakthroughs our country generates.
Manchester, birthplace of the Industrial Revolution, home to the father of atomic theory, John Dalton, and the father of modern computing, Alan Turing. Now, well, Manchester is the centre of a new revolution, another globally significant, game-changing black swan event, and it's called graphene.
The thinnest material in the world, graphene was discovered and isolated 10 years ago at the University of Manchester. One atom thick, but 200 times stronger than steel, graphene has a staggering range of potential applications that could revolutionise everything from fuel and electronics to medicine. Dr. Sarah Hay works alongside the Nobel Prize-winning scientists who discovered it.
Graphene has come up with huge surprises and is continuing to open our eyes, new opportunities. The strength, the stiffness, the transparency, the conductivity, all of those things combined in one material is really, really unusual.
Now, this is a global thing, isn't it? I mean, it's not just happening here at Manchester. I mean, there are laboratories all over the world going great guns and all this.
And a lot of work is going in to transitioning from laboratory-type investigations deep within the universities into smaller start-up companies that can start that transition into real applications.
So the key is we've got to make sure these start-ups actually scale up and grow.
Absolutely.
To that end, the university is building Britain's National Graphene Institute, where industry and academics will work side by side, sharing ways to drive commercialization forward.
So behind these doors are a number of labs.
It'll be the job of the Institute's business director, James Baker, to make that a reality.
This is the heart of what we call graphene at Manchester. So when you move around this building, you'll be bumping into the end user in aerospace or defense. You'll be talking to the supply chain. You'll be talking to the academic side.
The ambition to make Manchester kind of graphene city 2050, like it was cotton city in 1850, you've really got to admire it. I mean, you need an infrastructure like this, but I mean, will James get answers from the companies that he's trying to engage in this technology?
Watching with you, laughing with you, sharing with you.
This concept ad from Samsung presents a vision for the next generation of electronic displays, one that may increasingly be driven by graphene. Samsung is spending heavily on graphene research, and so are many other foreign companies.
It's getting closer to you.
China has taken out more than 2,200 patents on graphene, the US, 1,700, South Korea, nearly 1,200, and Britain, the country that discovered graphene, barely 100. Just 1% of all global patents. And this is symptomatic of a wider failure. There aren't enough British firms with the owners and backing ready to capitalize on such wonderful inventions. Without them, we're going backwards.
30 years ago, Britain spent more on research and development as a share of national output than virtually all our competitors. Today, that's reversed. The United States, Germany, Japan, France, all outspend us.
Gosh.
I'm visiting one hugely successful British company that does invest in R&D, routinely an astonishing third of its profits, with just recently a commitment to spend another billion on top. These are some of the latest innovations to emerge from the testing labs of Sir James Dyson.
James.
21 years after launching his bagless vacuum cleaner, Dyson remains owner of the multi-billion pound business he built.
Why the Harrier outside?
Because it's a wonderful British invention. You know, the vertical takeoff aeroplane. No one managed to do it. A British company did. And it's an example of British ingenuity and British technology and British manufacturing, which is sadly disappearing.
And you want that statement outside your office?
I want that statement as you come into our building. I want everybody to be reminded that Britain can be great and that we were once and we can be again.
How important is it that you have remained a company that you own, infused with your passion?
Well, I've always looked at it very simplistically. The industry is a very long-term thing. And, I mean, this motor took us 12 years till we got it to the state where we could manufacture it and put it into a product. We invested $200 or $300 million in that. And one or two of our non-executive directors, while during that 12 years, said, what on earth are you doing wasting that money on electric motors? And the answer is that it now makes our hand dryers possible. It makes our hand vacuum cleaners on a stick, digital slim vacuum cleaners, which is now 60% of our business.
Dyson was criticised for moving production to Asia in 2002, losing 800 production jobs. But 13 years later, he's employing more than 1,000 engineers in Britain and planning to triple the number. Ownership, knowledge, ideas, and smart jobs stay here. As a country, we benefit, just as America gains from the success of Apple. And beyond the business, Dyson is investing tens of millions in British universities.
We're investing very long term in university projects and our own projects to make sure we have much more advanced technology than our global competitors. There are 1,500 engineers out there, young engineers, and they're bursting with new ideas. Half of them I don't understand. I mean, it's modern technology, electronics and algorithms. And, you know, Dyson's being built up by them. It's perfectly possible in a very short space of time for British companies to harness the technology and design capability that we have here and make products that the world wants.
We can't talk to James Dyson without ending up being optimistic. The company is imbued with the attitude of its founder and its owner. It wants to live on the edge, it wants to be at the frontier, it wants to take risks.
There are lots more James Dysons out there. We just need to give them the structures to create the great companies we need. We should be gearing everything to building more long-term owners, more R&D, more financial backing.
Companies at their best are organizations of genius, innovating, solving problems, and delivering great goods and services. They shouldn't be allowed to degrade into instruments for making quick killings on the stock exchange. Addressing this should be top of the political agenda, but it's not. Yet it's the route to higher living standards and opportunity. It's in our hands. Do nothing and fail, or go for change and succeed.
Was Richard III guilty beyond reasonable doubt of killing his nephews in the Tower? At 9 tonight, Channel 4 brings together some of the world's greatest experts to examine the evidence. And before that, shattering icebergs and a rainbow in all its glory. No room for a pot of gold, though. Some of the weirdest weather coming up